Last time, I gave the outline of the proof of the following proposition, which is like one of our main two steps to proving the main theorem. So this says that after you connect some with one of these overtwisted disks, you can fill one of these standard Hamiltonian context shell models. So if K is special and you have K less than or equal to some K0 as it maps from this domain, this cylindrical domain, then for any contact ball, with this overtwisted disk on its boundary, we have that if you perform a connect sum of this special, this any contact Hamiltonian with this contact ball, then after doing this connect sum, you have a genuine contact structure. We have this as a genuine, is equivalent to a genuine contact structure. So, and what's left from last time is, so let me write down the main thing we need to prove. So, the thing I didn't prove, so I gave the proof of this. I explained how it would work in general, up to one main lemma that I showed how to prove this lemma in dimension 3. And I, for higher dimensions, where this needing to be special will appear. So let me remind you of the main lemma that we need. And this is, for K special, then there exists a contact embedding from delta to what happens if you perform a connect sum of these two deltas with one that it just is translation. It's z goes to z plus 1 plus l on z greater than or equal to some zd. And two, you have that if you push forward k, you get less than or equal to k connect sum. So that's what we need to prove. So just to recall, what are these things and these things? So you have that K connects on K, the map from. So you just stack the domains, these cylindrical domains, delta, side by side. So it's like this. And you put a gap of L minus L minus 2 plus L. So here's one copy of delta. Here's the other copy of delta. And here's this neck region you put in between. And in here, you just put K. Here you put K. And inside here, you put this function e, where e of u is just k of u plus minus 1. Okay, so finally, what is this, finally, the special family of functions that will let us prove this? So, definition. So first, just a smooth function, little k, to R is special if you have the following properties: if its value at 1 is positive, and it satisfies the following inequality. So A times K U over A is less than K of U for all A bigger than 1 and U bigger than or equal to 0. So that's the main property, and this is this conditions, I don't know, well, tells you something about how it behaves with respect to scaling. But if you want to, a nice way to think about what this condition is just in terms of the graph. So note, star implies the following condition, which is that KU minus U K prime of U is less than or equal to 0 for all U. And this can be interpreted as like the y-intercept of the graph K at each point of U. So here's 1, and you want it to be something like this. And then I'll draw it slightly wilder. And then the point is that at any point here, if you draw this tangent line, where this hits is precisely KU minus U, K prime U. So in particular, any linear function with positive slope and k 1 bigger than 0 is special. Well, with sufficiently positive slope. With large slope. And K, 1 bigger than 1, 0. All right, so that's, and now we're just going to define a special function on this domain delta to be one that looks like one of these functions in some small z interval. So, to k, which is just a function of the coordinates u and z, from delta cylinder to R, is special if there exists a special little k where 1, you have that k of u z is always bigger than or equal to this little k of u, and 2, you have k of u of z is little k of u in when Z is in some neighborhood of some ZD with ZD and -1, 1. So here's our domain delta 1, -1, 1, and then we have some, so this is some ZD. So in this region, we just have the function little k, and outside, this is all right, so what do we need to do? We need to write down an embedding from, let me draw. So from this domain into this domain, which I'll draw again. So where it's 2 plus L, L minus L, -2, -L. And here we have K, here we have K, and here we have E. So we need to write down some embedding of the domains. We need to write down some contact embedding like this of the domains that respects k here. I'm just not putting anything there. So this is. So we want to write down an embedding from this domain to this domain such that after we push forward capital K, it's less than or equal to this thing. And basically, what's the strategy? The strategy is we're going to basically stretch this domain in this region where we know precisely what capital K is to get this region. We have to, obviously you can't just stretch to precisely map this domain to this domain, but you stretch and then we'll do it in something else. So we'll map this domain to this domain basically morally just by stretching this blue region where we know exactly what's happening. And then what's going to pop out after we push the Hamiltonian capital K forward is it's going to this, for the push forward, it's precisely this formula that's going to show up. So this is going to be what the push forward Hamiltonian looks like. And then we're supposed to compare it to this, which was the old Hamiltonian. So that's how it works. So to contact embeddings. So yes, we finally want, this is actually contact isomorphism. So what do we build these from? Two, there's two different ones. So one, we can have a scaling. And this is like the kind of obvious contact morphism you can write down that scales the z coordinate. So just recall that this is all happening in R(2n-1) with the contact form lambda. So equals lambda equals dz plus sum of ui API. So the scaling, you can stretch the z-coordinate however you want. So given a diffeomorphism little h of R, define capital phi h to map R to n minus 1 to itself by z ui vi is you do the diffeomorphism to z and then you scale the u coordinates by h prime. And this basically, so we can stretch the z-coordinate however we want at the cost of also scaling the u-coordinate at the cost of the derivative. And then the other one we have is twisting. So let's just suppose we just tried to, so let's suppose we want to do the scaling. And we wanted to take this and stretch it to this. So you could map, so with this alone, can map 1 minus 1, 1 to, if you try to stretch it out so it's length minus 2L to L, it's going to be at the cost of some derivative. So this is phi h of L there, where you can make this minus 2 minus L, 2 plus L. But then this height here is going to be a basically h prime of z. And that's not, because we want to get to here. So the twisting contacting morphism lets you push this back down to where it's supposed to be. So for C, so just for any function, define psi g by the formula. And this does nothing to the z-coordinate, it just acts on the u and v-coordinate. So it's z to the following formula, ui over 1 plus g of z, ui, comma, vi minus the antiderivative of g of z, dz. And this is, in general, this will be a contactomorphism. From the domains 1 plus g of z u greater than 0 to 1 minus g of z u greater than 0. And in particular, it basically lets you change, by picking g appropriately, you can change this height to be whatever thing you want in the following way. So an example, suppose you have two domains, this is defined by u less than or equal to f of z, and this is defined by u less than or equal to f1 of z. You have a contactomorphism between these two regions given by these are contactomorphic. With G of Z being 1 over F1 of Z minus 1 over F2 of Z. So we can obviously we start to map this region to this region by stretching it out along this right near ZD, which creates a huge hump. But then we can use this twist contactomorphism to push that hump down, so the shape looks like this. Again, because like so. So bringing these two together, so. Or H. Let G of Z equal 1 minus 1 over H prime of H inverse of Z. And then you have gamma of H, which is defined to be psi g composed vh, and this is will map u less than or equal to 1, absolute value of z less than or equal to 1, to u less than or equal to 1, z in h minus 1. So this, yeah, this is actually just. So you start off with this. You first map it to this region by stretching it out, and then, which is this map, and then you apply this example with F2 being this function, and F1 just being the constant one function, and so you map. Do whatever you want to do, keeping the height the same. And so if you write out the composition, the two composing these two formulas, you get the following formula that just in terms of the u and z coordinates, you get that this equals h prime of z times u over 1 plus h prime of z minus 1 times u, comma, h of z. And we also wanted, so this is going to be the thing we use to build, for appropriate choice of h, this will be our contact isomorphism. So we also want to know what this contactomorphism does to Hamiltonians. So you have that the following formula. And it's the following. So if you push forward a contact Hamiltonian, you get the following that's K of u over where h tilde of u z equals h prime of h inverse of z minus h prime minus 1 times u. And let me just note that this is, this h twiddle is greater than or equal to 1 if h prime is always greater than or equal to 1 and u is restricted to be less than or equal to 1. Just because what's its graph, its graph is. So for fixed z, so when u equals 0, it's sitting out at h prime of h inverse of z. And when u equals 1, those two combine to give you just 1. And so this is going to be the kicker, because this is precisely, I'm going to write it down in a second, but we're going to only, we're going to pick h so it only does stuff interesting where k, capital K equals lowercase k. And there, once capital K equals lowercase k, this term is no longer here. And you just have some number bigger than or equal to 1 times k of u divided by some number bigger than or equal to 1. So it's precisely the left-hand side of this, with h twiddle taking the place of a. I'll write that down again, but that's from this formula is how this property was chosen. All right, so we just need to pick an appropriate lowercase h to apply this. So what do we want? So we want something, it's always going to be translation on the right-hand side, and then it has to map the interval minus 1 to 1 to this stretched out interval. So proof of lemma. So let little h be a diffeomorphism to minus 2 minus l to 2 plus l, such that 1, that you have that h prime is always bigger than or equal to 1, with inequality only near ZD, and 2, it's H of 1 equals, well, it goes to 2 plus L, and H of minus 1 is 2 minus is minus 2 minus 1. So the graph of this is something like this. So it starts off just with slope 1, which is translation at the endpoints. And then it develops a huge slope near ZD. So it's just translation. Outside the purple region. All right, now we just compute. Well, we have, look at this formula. So let's note two things we have. So where h prime of z is just 1, you have that h twiddle just equals one. So you have that gamma h push forward to capital K is just translation u h inverse of z. And where and near z equals zd, you have that, well, I should really write, near z equals h of zd, you have is this formula here, but so I'll write it out in two steps. So it's, well, it's, you have, all right, have that k of zu, have k equals lowercase k, by our assumption, this. So looking at that formula over there and replacing capital K with just lowercase k, the z dependence goes away, and you just have this. So it's equal to h twiddle of u z times lowercase k of u over h twiddle u of z. And by assumption, this is less than or equal to lowercase of ku. And by the special assumption, so by special, lowercase k. And then by this assumption 1, you have that this is less than or equal to k of uz for any, less than or equal to capital K of uz by this part 1. So this is R2. All right, so then we just put it together and we're done. So all together, we have that. Push forward of k, it's less than or equal to k of u h inverse of z. Z plus or minus 1 plus L at the ends, and it's lowercase k of u in the middle, but you have that k of u is less than or equal to capital K of u z, and it's also less than or equal, in particular, it's also less than or equal to k of u e of u, which is just k of u plus minus 1. And so, hence, you have that, which is what you want to. So, comments about, so what can we see from this proof? We came up with a way to, unfortunately the proof is not, like, this is obviously just like an ad hoc thing. Like, we came up with a way to embed one domain into the other, saw for our choice of embedding what functional equation you got when you pushed forward the Hamiltonian, and then chose a class of Hamiltonians that would satisfy what we needed. So it's very much possible that, and then from what we saw we needed, we enforced on from the get-go on what special Hamiltonians we needed to use. So it could be that, I don't know, through more work, it's conceivable that you could prove that, you could loosen this definition of special greatly by finding more intricate ways of embedding one domain into the other. Like, this definite threshold is just an artifact of this precise part of the proof. All right, and so then this is what us from, so we proved this lemma, and this was the thing that was missing from last time that showed how, after doing a connect sum, you can fill one of these b sub k's as long as the disk you're connect summing with is defined by a special Hamiltonian. So, are there questions about this? Because then the next thing is when I start changing gears. Yeah, you take what this neighborhood is, and you make this purple region small enough so that it, you, so like you say, you know this is true for z in some interval. And then you pick H so that the purple region is contained inside. Because we have complete freedom in this choice of H. So we choose to only do something drastic nearer where we have precise, where we've made like a very precise assumption about what capital K looks like. Okay, so this completes the kind of like the one of the main ingredients of the proof. And so for the rest of today and next time, we'll talk about the other main ingredient. So, and it's the following proposition. So this is this completes proof of prop 3.9, one of the main parts of the main theorem. The rest of time about the other main proposition. All right, and what does this one say? So this is the one that says that, so what was the main proposition we proved? It showed that as long as you can use an overtwisted disk to fill one of these B sub Ks, provided your overtwisted disk is defined by a Hamiltonian that's sufficiently small. But the other part is that we can always reduce our problem of taking any almost contact structure to a bunch of the problems where the only failures to be contact are these B sub K models. And furthermore, like a specific B sub K. So it's the following. That for each dimension, there exists a universal with the following property, such that the following holds, that any almost contact structure is homotopic to another prime such that you have there is a disjoint collection of balls, B sub I and M. With disjoint collection, there's a where I equals 1 through L, where 1, M set minus the union of them, is genuine. So this almost contract structure is genuine outside this finite collection of balls, and 2 each. On each ball, you just have this universal model on it. And 2, bi, xz prime is equivalent as a contact shell. To bk universal. So this proposition lets us reduce being able to just figure out how to fill a fixed B sub K, and that's what we used, what we had previously been proving to do. So everything we've done previously is talking about how to fill one of these. And you do it by connect summing with one of these overtwisted disks. So let me, I'm not going to, this is, to prove this, we'll take this lecture and the next lecture. So before I dive in, let me give the outline of how it's going to go. So the way it's going to go is the following, that we're going to introduce, so introduce a new model of contact shell called we have well, called context saucer. And what we're going to be able to prove with this, so we prove 2 things with this. So, like, one of these denoted like this. And then with this, so this context saucer is kind of well designed to make, sorry. So this is related to our old B sub K in the following way. So prove this is proposition 6.12, which says that any semi-regular contact saucer B dominates some BK eta K for K So these semi-regular contacts, and for any one of them, you can put inside some b sub k. Dominates. And then 3, which is, I think, so it's split up into a couple of different propositions, but when you combine them all together, it says the following, that prove proposition 3.1 with BK universal, eta K universal, replaced by finite list of finite list depending only on dimension of contact saucers of these semi-regular contact saucers. So what it says is that you have a finite list of contact saucers depending on only on dimension, such that given any almost contact structure, you can homotope it to another one, such that it fails to be contact only in finite collection of balls, and on each ball, it's equivalent to one of the contact saucers on my list. Into my finite list. So compiling these together,
so that you not just work with contact sources because of the previous one.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So the these B sub K's are really well adapted to the previous stuff. And these contact saucers are yes, exactly. Yeah, and at least the way, as the proof's written, maybe there's some way around it, but this proposition 6.2 is actually used twice when this is proved. The interplay at least appears to, as the proof is currently written, seems to be also important. So you use 6.2 twice. Let me just say it together, proving. So you have this finite list by item 3, and item 2 tells you for each one on this list, you can find some B sub K. So pick K universal delta cylinder to R to be such that BK universal eta K universal is dominated by each saucer in the finite list. from number 3. So why is this even possible? Well, so this is one of the nice things about these B sub k models, is that so for each one in the list, you get some B sub k. So now you have a finite list of k's. And then domination is very easy to establish for these B sub k's. You just take k to be smaller. Then each one of these gives you some k, and you take k universal to be less than all of those k's that you were given. So using that, if k1 is less than or equal to k2, then B sub k1 eta k1 is dominated by B sub k2 eta k2. So you just have a finite list of k's, and you pick one smaller than all. They're separate things, but you can the special k's are cofinal. You can always find, for any level, you can always find a special k that's less than that. So, but that's not really important, because the proof of what I previously showed was that you just need your overtwisted disk defined by a special thing that's less than this k universal. It doesn't matter that this k universal is special or not. You just need to be able to pick an overtwisted disk that's special and less than this k universal. But yeah, it would be nice. So this was, I guess, I remarked last time, like, we don't, or I guess previously I said this definition of special is kind of ad hoc. It would be nice if there was a nicer criterion for when a k was such that once you connect sums with it, you could fill the hole. Okay, so then you have this bk universal, and now you're done. So apply then number 3 combined with choice of k universal and with k universal proves this proposition. Okay, so this is the outline. All right, so now I guess in the time I have left, I'll introduce what these new models are, and then maybe say something about this, and then next time it'll mostly be about proving this. Because this is its own thing. Well, this is the proof of these are kind of, well, as the hard parts of both of them are kind of separate. But this one's more work. So regular semi-contact structures. So what are these? So a semi So these are let me motivate why these even show up. So they naturally arise in the following part of the proof once we start trying to prove this proposition. Once we start trying to prove number three. So let S2N subset of M2N plus 1 almost contact. So suppose you have some sphere in an almost contact structure. Then you can do the following. So I'm going to come back to what I said now. I'm just going to say it quickly so I can motivate why we're even considering these. So you can apply Gromov's H principle to M set minus, say, some neighborhood of the sphere. To get a contact structure, to get a new almost contact structure, like C prime, that is genuine away from S2N. And this, what I'm sketching right now, is what replaces the, so what I came up in the very first lecture when I was asked, why don't you just remove a point and apply Gromov's H principle to the almost contact manifold to remove a point. So this is, we do this instead. And what you have left is, so here's here's the sphere. And you have this neighborhood of it. And you have this as contact away from the sphere. All right, and now what do you have? You have you just now consider this annulus. So consider the annulus S to n times interval. And on this interval, you have that's where is genuine on, say, on V equals near, genuine near V equals plus or minus 1, but it's in between, it's just almost contact. So now you have on this, on these slices, you have a family of almost germs of almost contact structures. And you apply a parametric version of Gromov's H principle. So to the family of almost contact germs on S2N cross V. Apply Gromov again. So they're germs, so they're open. So it's really some small neighborhood of this slice. So I have a family of a one parameter family of almost contact structures on a neighborhood of this, which is an open manifold. So to get a smooth family. Of germs of contact structures. But the kicker is that they don't, you have the smooth family of germs, but they don't integrate to a well-deformed contact structure. You're just a family of germs that don't coalesce into a single contact structure. All right, so that's what a semi-contact structure is. Semi-contact structure is just a one-parameter family of germs of contact structures defined on an annular region. I'll write it out. Yeah. You're left with an semi-contact structure on the end. Yeah, I'll write it on the annulus. Yeah, so you're using injectivity of contact to almost contact on op of this. So you have contact structures at the ends, and they're connected by an almost contact structure, and you replace it by a path of contact structure. So, the definition, a semi-contact structure on sigma 2n times some interval is a smooth family of germs of contact structures. On the slices. And these, in almost a semi-contact structure, uniquely determines almost contact structure. On this annulus. So using this deduction to semi-contact structure is how we finally get the proof rolling for this, and it's why we're considering. All right, so what's an example of one of these? Let this be a genuine contact structure on, say, sigma cross R, and let take a smooth family of functions. So smooth family of functions. Then define the germ on sigma s to be the germ on the graph of phi s as a subset of sigma cross r. All right, so that's now, so what's a saucer? So a saucer is the following object. So it's let D2N be a disk, and then consider B to the subset WV inside D times R, such that it's stuck, those values V, they're stuck between two functions. Where F minus is less than or equal to F plus on the interior of D, and are equal with the infinity jets on the boundary of D. So the graph, so if this is D, that's like so these, a saucer comes, so B is foliated by disks D sub S, which is just B equals 1 minus S F minus of W plus. So you just interpolate these graphs between the two. So this is D sub S. And a semi-contact structure on B is a family of germs on DS, where which agree. On the common boundary. So on each one of these slices, you have a germ of a contact structure, and they always agree at the boundary. And these, since they agree on the boundary, these together such a structure defines, gives B S the form of a contact shell is. Inside here, you have a ball. Its boundary consists of three pieces. Boundary consists of the top part, where it's a germ of a contact structure. And so in particular, it's a germ. It's a genuine contact structure. On the bottom, you have a genuine contact structure. And then on this common boundary, all the germs agree. So they are also agree, give you a contact structure on the boundary. Okay, so finally, so the ones we're really going to be dealing with are these regular semi-contact saucers. And this is, so you consider R2N plus 1. With the standard contact structure being given by the kernel of this lambda standard plus v dt, where v is negative yn and t is xn. And you let D be this disk inside this hyperplane. B equals 0. So this would be a disk. That is regular. And so regular means that i.e. that the thing you get by taking D mod F is star-shaped contact domain. Where this script f is the characteristic foliation on this hyperplane subset of 2n plus 1. And it's spanned by just the dt direction. So the picture to have in mind is here is So here R2n is ZT. So this capital pi is this the blackboard, and we have some disk D here. And the character's foliation is just the T coordinates. So you're asked, they look, there's these directions. So these are the leaves of the foliation. And then it projects down to just the Z coordinate. As this domain. So this is what you want. But obviously D could, because you're just from the get-go asking that D could be a disk. So D could, so this is, yeah, like this, so bad. What you want, what you're ruling out is this, like the disk looking like. Then well, it's not even going to be smooth once you do this, once you quotient by these lines. Because like this and this become different things. So in quotient to and so let, so given one of these regular disks, so take a function p to d smooth with its positive than zero on near the boundary but on the inside. And two, that's equal zero with infinity j on the actual boundary. So you're looking at the graph like this. Something like that. And so define the saucer B to be W V in B times R such that 0 is less than or equal to V less than or equal to capital F of W, where F equals V on op boundary of the disk, and give the disk D sub S subset of B the germ associated to the graph of S V is a subset of R2n plus 1. All right, so this, we have this, this is D and this is, so on a given slice. D sub S. On this slice, you put the just the germ associated to the graph of the scaled down function of phi. And so this defines so up to diffeomorphism B's independent of the choice of F. And you get this construction builds you regular semi-context. What we call a so the result. The result is a regular semi-contact saucer. B, and it's up to diffeomorphism. Depends only on this function phi and the domain, well, and D. Independent of the choice of F you use to define the domain. All right, so those are what we're going to finally, we're going to use these to break up our space into some finite collection of these. And how are these finally going to be related to these models P sub K? That's where this regular condition comes in. Because you have, here's your domain D, which you basically think of, it's roughly looking like capital delta times interval. And our B sub K is redefined as capital delta times S1. So you have some graph over capital delta times interval. And our B sub K's are some graph over capital delta times S1. And through that connection is how we're going to be able to relate these semi-context, regular semi-context saucers to our B sub K models of previously. But that will be next time.